गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल ऑफ यू. एम आई ऑडिबल टू ऑल ऑफ यू?
यस सर.
यस सर.
ओके, सो वी विल स्टार्ट टुडेज सेशन. सो बिफोर स्टार्टिंग द सेशन आई वुड लाइक टू ब्रीफली इंट्रोड्यूस माई सेल्फ. आई एम संतोष कावरे, वर्किंग एज अ एडिशनल एग्जीक्यूटिव इंजीनियर इन MSA TCL. सो टोटल 16 ईयर्स आई हैव कंप्लीटेड हियर इन MSA TCL. So at the time of joining, I joined at 400 by 220 kV substation at Padghe. You know, Padghe is a hub, power hub of Maharashtra. One third of power of Maharashtra is handled by single substation, that is Padghe 400 by 220 kV substation. So there are another levels also, 100, 22, another levels are also there. And near to that, HVDC station is connected. So for some years I work at EHV substation Padghe. Later on I worked at that HVDC terminal station Padghe. So near about 14 years I have completed at Padghe substation, EHV as well as HVDC. So during this period, actually I worked in the maintenance as well as operation of EHV and HVDC systems. Later on, recently I transferred to State Load Dispatch Center, where I am working as a additional executive engineer, Renewable Energy Management Center. So I am looking after the SCADA system of the REMC. And I also completed my M.Tech in power system, and my topic of my dissertation was specialization in voltage source converter based HVDC, and I also published some of the papers in national and international conferences. So this is my brief introduction. So we will start today's our topic of our guest lecture, that is HVDC systems and static var compensator operations. So first of all, we'll start from the basics of HVDC. So this is a typical arrangement of the any HVDC terminal station, or we can say transmission system. So here at one end there is a generator, and at another end there is a load. But thing is not like this always. It may happen that there are two generators here, two generating systems that may get connected by HVDC or by one end, or two substations which are in the grid can also be connected by the HVDC system. So this is a one AC system and this is another AC system, and HVDC is the transmission link which connects two AC systems. So here at one terminal, one end, that is a rectifier station, and another end is known as inverter station, where AC is converted into DC, thus DC is transmitted over certain distance, nearly we can say more than 500 kilometer distance, that is a break even distance for the DC transmission, 500 to 700 kilometers, but it is always more than 500 kilometers when we talk about the thyristor based technology. But for another technology we can go for any distance, that is voltage source converter based. So our mainly concern in the today's presentation will be both sides of HVDC, that is current source converter based as well as voltage source converter based. So this is a one end where thyristor valves are used. Normally in India we are having a all means near about 10 to 12 projects are there, and some of are under execution. So out of that, all HVDC systems are having thyristor based technology, that is current source converter based technology. And one of the HVDC link that is now again in the commissioning stage, so that is based on the voltage source converter. So that is a ripe. That is Pugalur HVDC. So that is the first application of voltage source converter in Indian grid. So later on we will see that thing. So this is a rectifier here where AC is converted into DC. Again at the inverter station, DC is converted into AC. So in this way, there are two AC systems connected by the DC system. Why we go for HVDC? We know that generally we talk about the bulk power transmission over longer distances. This is the major benefit of the HVDC system. Also, we are getting the benefits like stability in the power system. So that is also one of the major advantage of HVDC system. When we say there is a conversion from AC to DC, so actually when we use the current source converter, that is thyristors, so thyristor converts AC current into DC current. Again at the inverter station, that DC current is converted into AC current. So in this way we can say that when we use thyristors, that is current source converter, it converts current directly and voltage indirectly. In this way we can say. But when we use IGBTs or voltage source converters, then that converts voltage directly and current indirectly. So later on we'll have again discussion on it. So this is the basic design of the any converter station. This is the monopolar HVDC terminal station. So this is the AC switch yard. When we talk about the rectifier station, so this will be the starting point, rectifier station. From here it will start. But when you talk about the inverter station, so generally it starts from here. So this is AC switch yard. These are the converter transformers. These are the thyristor walls. These are the suspended hanging structures, which actually take two part into the conversion from AC to DC or DC to AC. And converter transformers are supporting into that action of conversion. That's why these transformers are known as converter transformers. Means it helps in the process of conversion from AC to DC or DC to AC. So here AC switch yard. In the AC switch yard we have the harmonic filters. So here passive filters are used where RLC components generally used. Then shunt capacitors. Shunt capacitors, it is not necessary to each terminal station there are shunt capacitor provided. Whenever there is a reactive power deficient region, particularly that area, then additional shunt capacitors we needed. Otherwise harmonic filters are sufficient. Here thyristor walls and converter transformers. And here this is the DC side. This area is a DC side, and after these converters, so that is the thyristor walls, this is the AC switch yard. So this is the typical arrangement of any monopolar converter station. So this is a tower. This is, we can say, a tower in the switch yard. So line is coming. This is the end of that line. And this is the DC line. From here DC line comes. So this is a monopolar converter station. So we will having a this question answer session at the end, so that there should not be any disturbance, and later on we can freely discuss it. First we will learn the things, then we can discuss. Here when we talk about the substation equipments, then we divided HVDC equipments into three major areas. One is AC side equipments, another is thyristor walls, and next one is a DC side. In AC side, which are the equipments connected? If you talk about the AC side, converter transformers are there. Then this is a isolator. Then this is a converter breaker. In series there is a DCCT. Again there is a isolator. And this is the portion of AC filter, passive filters. And this is the DVD for DC hold, sorry, is a CVT, capacitance voltage transformer, which measures the voltage into the AC side. This ACCT measures the AC current and this is the passive filter for harmonic elimination as well as reactive power support. So these are the two functions of the AC filters. Generally the converter transformers are three winding transformers. So it is connected into primary is connected into star, which is grounded, and secondary is connected in delta and star, but this star is not grounded. So this is the arrangement. Next we are having the thyristor walls. These are the thyristor walls, 6 pulse converter in series. It is a 12 pulse converter, and there are the arrestors. These are the lightning arrestors for the protection of the thyristor walls. Then we have for the protection or we can say cooling of the thyristor walls, there should be demineralized water circulation system to exchange the heat from the thyristor walls. Whenever there is a operation of the thyristor walls, the anode and cathode heats. So when that heat that is connected with the heat sinks, and through the heat sinks demineralized water is passed on. That demineralized water takes heat from the anode and cathode, and then it is circulated in it is cooled down at the surrounding. There are the water coolers, and later on that same water is used in the circuit. Why DM water we used? So there should not be any we can say conductivity there, otherwise there will be the short circuit of the thyristors. So we have to always monitor the cooling system. It is a very sensitive part of the thyristor walls. Cooling must be maintained at a particular temperature, as well as the conductivity of that DM water should be maintained, and the flow of water is also is important. If the flow changes, then there is a tripping. If the conductivity goes on higher side, then also cold trips. If cooling is not there, heat is there too much, insufficient cooling, then also pole HVDC pole trips. So these are the some of the cares we have to take when we maintain the thyristor walls. Here in the now it is a DC side. In DC side we are having the smoothing reactor. Smoothing reactor, the function of smoothing reactor to smoothen the DC output and also suppress some of the harmonics. And these are the DC filters. These are the DC filters to take out or minimize the harmonics into the system. And here it is a DVD for DC voltage. It's a DC voltage divider to measure the DC voltage, and to measure the DC current we are having DCCTs, DC current transducer. DCCTs, DC current transducer. And then we are having a isolator and like that. And this is the neutral portion. This is the main pole, and this is the return path of that pole. So this is the neutral path, and neutral path there is a MRTB, metallic return transfer breaker. This is the one of the breaker which is used for the isolation of the system during maintenance, as well as there is a tripping of the poles, then this MRTB, metallic return transfer breaker, is used. So in HVDC you will never find out any breaker on the main pole. So why it is so, we will discuss later on. Please remind me also why DC breaker is not there in the DC side. Just whatever breakers they are used, these are only SF6 types, simple or conventional breakers. And there is a one special breaker is known as MRTB, metallic return transfer breaker, which is we can call as semi DC breaker, not perfectly DC breaker, but it is a semi DC breaker we can say. Or otherwise all breakers which are used in the neutral part, these are only our conventional circuit breakers. So these are the equipments in the DC switch yard. Now to learn the simple analogy of HVDC system with the battery system, our rectifier station is acting as a one of the like a variable battery. and another inverter station is acting as a another DC variable battery. Simply we can say there is two batteries when we connect in the parallel, so that forms the HVDC system. But these DC batteries or DC sources are variable sources, where by adjusting the firing angle we can vary the output. So that's a difference. And here it is a inductance, that is a smoothing reactor of the rectifier end. This is the line resistance, and this is the again here inductor. So this is the smoothing reactor at the inverter end, and this is the, we can say, inverter thyristor walls at inverter side. And we know that in this power system, power flows always flows from higher to lower potential. It means that if I want to transmit power from rectifier to inverter, so the voltage at rectifier must be at the higher side than inverter. Then and then power will flow from rectifier to inverter. And in HVDC, power reverse power flow is possible. In that case, what things happen? Rectifier will act as an inverter and inverter will act as a rectifier by adjusting the firing angles. And this polarity of the voltage changes. Positive pole will be negative and negative pole will be positive. So this is the simple battery analogy of the HVDC system. HVDC system is not that much complicated, which we assume. Otherwise, this is a simply battery analogy. Then this is a single line diagram of a typical converter station. We already talked about the equipments. So this is the DC side. We are having the, this is a isolator. This is DC CT. This is a DVD, DC voltage divider. These are filters, and this is a lightning arrester, and in the DC side. And this is DVD, DC voltage divider, to measure the DC voltage. And this is smoothing reactor. Again, this is earthing switch. During outages, maintenance, shutdown, we have to connect this to de-energize the charging current of the walls. Then these are the wall arresters, and this is 6 pulse converter in series. And their middle point is also grounded. Middle point is also, we can say, not grounded. It is actually connected through the lightning arrester. Whenever there is any heavy lightning is there, so that can be passed on through this into the earth. In this way, the walls can be protected from the lightnings. In the second, in the AC side, these are the converter transformers. So it is a star delta, and it is star star. One star is common on the primary side, and star star is connected to the upper 6 pulse converter, and star delta is connected to the lower 6 pulse converter. So here, later on, it is a CVT, capacitance voltage transformer. This is lightning arrester, this is circuit breaker, then this is isolator, and these are the AC side filters where RLC components are used. This is R, this is C, and this is L, and these are the isolators. So in this way, this AC switch yard, converter station, converter or wall area we can say, and this is a DC yard. So here in the AC switch yard, odd harmonics are removed. We can say that odd harmonics are present in the AC side and even harmonics present in the DC side. That depends on the formula Pn plus minus 1. Pn plus minus 1. P is a pulse group. P varies from 6 pulse, 12 pulse, 24 pulse, like that. N is an integer number starting from 1, 2, 3, and so on. So Pn plus minus 1, if I take the value of P is a 6, that is 6, so N is 1, so my first harmonic for the 6 pulse converter in the AC side will be 5th and 7th harmonic. For N is equal to 2, it will be 11th and 13th harmonic. But here 11th and 13th harmonic filters are provided because we are using the 12 pulse converter. So the lower order harmonics, by adopting the star delta structure, we are cancel out the lower order harmonics, that is 5th and 7th, fifth and seventh produced by upper six pulse converter will be cancelled out by the lower six pulse converter with the help of this 30 degree phase shift of star delta. That's why in the secondary of the converter transformer there is a 30 degree phase shift. It means that fifth and seventh harmonic produced by one converter will be get cancelled out by the other. So there is a saving of the filters. Otherwise, if you not cancel out, again we have to install harmonic filter for fifth and seventh harmonic. So this is the, that's why the star delta arrangement is used. Same thing is shown here also. Shunt capacitor, AC filters, converter transformers. These are the thyristor walls, smoothing reactor, DC filters, and here transmission line or cable. As a transmission media, we can use either transmission line or we can use cable also. Now HVDC is not just a transmission. We know that this is the era of now artificial intelligence. So we are also trying for that our power system. In power system also we are trying to implement artificial intelligence technologies so that our power system should behave in real time with the maximum stability. So HVDC doesn't mean it's just for transmission. It is like a intelligent link. And we know that the communication medium used for the rectifier and inverter station is a fiber optic communication. So the data exchange between the rectifier and inverter or this fiber optics communication with the speed of light means whenever there is some issues at any terminal station, those quantities or parameters will be shared with the other terminal station via fiber optics, and accordingly both the terminal station can take the decision. So that is also one of the way. Or locally also at terminal station there are the DVDs, DCCTs, CVTs and DCCTs. So that also sends the changes in the voltage as well as frequencies. So according to that, this link will take the decisions. So that's why HVDC controllers are known as intelligent controllers. So they take the fast decision and protect the system from collapse. Here we can minimize or corrected AC voltage or frequency variations, then power can be changed very quickly in HVDC. You can reverse the power that not that much time required, it immediately it can be reversed also. There are the modes of HVDC. A reverse power mode can be activated. Then this power exchange is practically independent of the frequency at the buses. When we talk about the HVDC transmission, then that power transmission is independent of the frequency at the buses, power transmission angle, that is delta, and voltage level at the buses. And also it acts as a generator near to the load centers. This is one of the biggest advantage of the HVDC system. Suppose take the case of Chandrapur Padiya HVDC terminal station or HVDC project, we can say. So there, this is the 1500 megawatt link. So whenever we transmit power from Chandrapur eastern part of Maharashtra to the western part of Maharashtra, that is Padiya near to Mumbai, so near about 1500 megawatt power in normal power rating we transmit. Then it is having a 1650 megawatt capacity plus minus it's a 150 megawatt plus, that is again 2 hours overload rating for the HVDC system. And we have 5 seconds overload rating, that is 2000 megawatt. We can load this link. It is designed for the 1500 megawatt, but we can load it up to 2000 megawatt, but just for the 5 seconds, because that mode is only activated in case of islanding operation. So that's why that's the emergency mode. And the benefit of HVDC that it acting as a generator near to the load center. We are producing power near about here 752 kilometer distance at Chandrapur, and when that power come to the Mumbai near, that is Padghe, so that whenever that fitted on that AC bus, then that bus is acting as a generator system, because this HVDC system transmit power in stable manner, as well as there is no variations, that variations are very less and losses are very less. Because when we talk about the AC transmission, there are 3 to 4% losses are there, but when we transmit that power with the DC, so there are only 1 to 1.5% losses. Whatever I am producing 1500 megawatt, near about with the loss of 1 or 1.5%, I am getting at the another end. That's why at another end system behaves like a generator. I have 3 generators of, that is 1500 megawatt, that we have connected to the Padghe bus. So that's why that bus is acting as a very, we can say, stable, and it acting as a generator bus. So that is the biggest advantage of the HVDC system near load center. So this is the power transmission in case of AC transmission. Power transmission in AC is depends on the rectifier, sending end and receiving end voltages, and the distance and power angle, that is sine delta, that is alpha 1 minus alpha 2. But when we talk about the DC transmission, so that power depends on the UDC, that is DC voltage and DC current. We can say that U1, U2, X, sine, delta, everything is absent here. So that's why system is very stable, because of these voltages. It is independent of the voltages, distance, as well as the power angle. So this is the comparison between AC and DC systems regarding power transmission. Now, the comparison of AC versus DC regarding cost. So it is the plot between the distance versus investment cost. So when we install any AC system, EHV substation, so there is some substation cost, which is a fixed cost, and there is a line, some cost is involved, operational cost. So that operational cost goes on increasing whenever distance increases. The operational cost in the AC transmission increases. But when we use the DC transmission, though the terminal station cost is higher, also line cost, initial installation cost is higher, but when the operation of the link starts, beyond the critical distance or break-even point, near about 500 to 700 kilometer, DC transmission is more economical than the AC transmission. So this is the again one of the advantage of the DC transmission. So it doesn't mean that whenever distance is more than 500 to 700 kilometer, you should always go for DC. No, we have also choices. Like, we can go for this AC system, EHV AC, with the compensation. We can give compensation to the line. Means we can use FACTS technology instead of going for the DC, because DC project is having the tremendous cost. Capital cost is more, though the operational cost is less, but the capital cost is more. So we can say that to establish any 400 kV EHV substation, you might be needed 400 to 500 crores rupees. But when you go for the HVDC any system, then near about 1500 to 2000 crores rupees we require. This is a roughly estimate. So near about, we can say that 400 kV substation can be covered, or we can compensate that cost in one DC project. So that's why we can say that it is always not preferable that you should go for the DC. So you have the options like EHV AC, then you can go for 765 kV, 1200 kV AC, like that. So we have the another options also. This is the cost structure of any terminal station, how maximum cost is involved into the thyristor valves and converter transformers. These are the costly equipments of the HVDC systems. Now we'll see some brief historical background of HVDC transmission, how this system came into existence. So in 1880s, Thomas Alva Edison had developed this. He has started actually transmitting the DC power to the New York City and supplied to some of the consumers. So this was the just starting of the electricity era. And in the same period, the AC was developed by Nikola Tesla, and that there was a one concept that is which technology is preferable, whether AC or DC. So that started the war of currents. So in war of currents, we know that today all over world AC is mostly accepted everywhere, and DC transmission is limited for the particular area, like for the bulk power transmission, for the longer distances we use the DC transmission. And nowadays people are using to connect the renewable energy sources with the new technology, HVDC technology, that is voltage source converter based technology, for the grid integration or grid connection, renewable energy sources grid integration. So for that DC technology they are using. So this was war of currents, but at particular application we can say that both technologies are good, nothing is there bad. 1882 to 1930s, there was a Thury systems developed by Michael Thury. So he has connected a number of DC generators in series, and common output of those generators he has connected to the lines and supplied to the some of the motor like loads. So this was the starting phase of HDC transmission, Thury systems. Then 1901, Haywitz has developed mercury vapor rectifier, and that was the born of HVDC. He has started using Peter Cooper's Haywitz mercury arc valves, and these were very bulky. There were chances of fire into these walls, and maintenance was too critical for this. So later on, this system is replaced with the mercury arc valves by Dr. Huno Lam. So in 1929, and for his contribution, he is known as the father of HVDC. Major revolution in the field of HVDC started after Dr. Huno Lam. He was an engineer with ABB. In 1945, there was an establishment of HVDC project in Berlin, 1945. But that project never came into operation because of it was the period of Second World War. And in 1954, first commercial HVDC started in between Sweden mainland to the island of Gotland. So this was the first commercial HVDC in 1954, and it was with the help of cables. The first DC transmission was with the help of cables, submarine cables. In 1960s, thyristors were invented, and first time in 1967, thyristors were used in the same project, this project, Gotland project. They have replaced these mercury arc valves with thyristors based technology. So in this way, in 1967, first time thyristors were used as a conversion media. Then in 1972, on the largest scale in Canada, up to 320 megawatt, they used thyristor valves. Later on, in 1979, these microcomputer based control equipments were developed, like control and protection system, that was microprocessor based. Then in 1984, in Brazil, there was the highest transmission voltage in the period of 1984. It was plus minus 600 kV, 3150 megawatt, and that project was to harness the hydropower and to feed that to the grid. So that project was installed. still it is there. And then in 1994, the first active DC filter based on the IGBTs, means this was the first IGBT based active DC filters were developed in the world. And in the same is used in the HVDC Padge and Chandrapur end also. This was one of the research by ABB. They have implemented IGBT based active DC filters. For 1 or 2 years it was in service. Later on, because of some is a cooling arrangement and some issues related with the control protection, so that is not working, but still that cubicles are there and some of the control and protection system is still working there. So this was the active DC filter. Then HVDC 2000, this was the concept given by ABB in 1995. In this they have developed thyristor walls, in outdoor thyristor walls, continuously tuned filters, contuned filters, that one filter can take the action on any harmonic. So that was contuned filters. Then in outdoor walls, in 1998 the first two countries get connected, Argentina and Brazil, with the first CCC HVDC. These are the Argentina and Brazil, they were get connected with the first CCC HVDC. CCC means capacitor commutated converters, where in between the thyristor walls and converter transformers we connect the series capacitors. Whenever there is a short circuit ratio of any system is low, to compensate that short circuit level, so we use such technology which is known as capacitor commutated converter based technology. And again, major revolution started from 1999 in the field of HVDC. First time in the world, first voltage source converter based transmission started in Gotland, Sweden. So this was the, they have, what they have, they did, they have connected their windmills to the, they fed this power from the windmills to the grid with the help of IGBT based technology. Otherwise, before 1999, all technology, that HVDC technology, based on the thyristors. And from 1999, this was the first application, and later on it is too much growing the use of voltage source converter based technology because of its advantages. In 2010, plus minus 800 kV, 6400 megawatt ultra high voltage DC transmission started in China's excess project. This is the Fulong site of there. It's a plus minus 800 kV. It's a ultra high voltage DC and having capacity of 6400 megawatt. In 2010, the another technology that is developed, that is based on the voltage source converter, but it is another renovation in the field of this VSC, that is MMC, modular multi-level converters, were used in this project between that is San Francisco, USA. So this is the first application of MMC HVDC in 2010. Then in India, we made one record. In the world, we made one record, that is world's first ultra high voltage DC with a multi-terminal feature. China is having HVDC plus minus 800 kV, but there are only two terminals. But whatever we have installed in India, and it is in service also, this link is having a three terminals. It's a ultra high voltage DC multi terminal features. So for this we have made record in the world. Its capacity is 6000 megawatt plus minus 800 kV. It's a northeast Agra project. From northeast region, we know that there is a hydro potential is there in the northeast region, and demand is more in the northern region. So that's why that power they are bringing from northeast area to the northern region of our country. And now China has made one record, that they have started ultra high voltage DC plus minus 1100 kV, having the capacity of 12 gigawatt, 12,000 megawatt power. they can transmit on the bipolar link, two bipolar link, with at a distance of 3,284 kilometer. So this is the China's one of the achievement, highest DC transmission voltage they have achieved, 1100 kV ultra voltage DC. They have, this project is in service in 2019. So this is a brief historical background of the HVDC transmission. But I have here given a star, that is a real history. We know that in history, whether it is technological history or we can say general history, some of the terms are missing. So here also, we, if you see, all the credit of this goes to the Swedish scientists or engineers or American people. But actually, we, if you see here, in 1945, there was a establishment of HVDC in Berlin. Means before this Gotland project, actually they have already used this HVDC system. But because of Second World War, that project never came into operation. So we can say that German scientists and engineers were the real inventors of HVDC technology. But because of that period, it never came out, never come into service. So this is the brief historical background of the DC transmission. Now why HVDC? Why we used HVDC? Just we can compare two persons. One person is running and another person is skating. So we know that when we run, we consume more and more power, internal energy we exhaust very early. But when we skate, so there is no issue and there is no much more internal energy loss. Why there is a loss when we run? Because there is a continuous up and down of the our legs. So AC system is like that. So there are continuous up and downs, that is 0 to positive maximum, 0, negative maximum, again the positive maximum, like this. So there is a continuous up and down. Okay. So this is a region, means we can say that there is a friction, electrical resistance. So just we, the help of one cartoon, we can see, show these things here. So this is a voltage, this is voltage, this is current, and this is a resistance. Whenever current has to pass, so it has to go against the resistance. In DC, line is having XL. If you see the value of, if you put the value of F is 0, because in DC system frequency is 0. So XL is 0 and XC is infinite, because XC is 1 upon 2 pi FC. So XC we are getting infinite and XL is 0. That's why there is no inductive and capacitive reactance to the line. Line has only resistance. If you take the case of Chandrapur Padge project, so from Chandrapur to Padge there is a distance of 752 km and the line resistance is only 8 ohm. So this we can say that this small amount of resistance offered in case of DC. But when we talk about the AC system, again it has to go against, current has to go against RLC, that is impedance. So that is the, that's why we can say that the losses in the AC system are more. So in AC, our electrical power system, the generally power is developed at the low voltages, then it is step up at EHV voltages, then it is step down. So HVDC majorly plays role in the transmission sector, but nowadays the new technology, that is voltage source converter based technology, they are using in we can say distribution level, that is low voltage levels, for the grid integration. So this is the one another application of HVDC systems. So now we'll having some brief overview of HVDC systems in India. These are the thyristor walls inside pictures. So these are the some of the HVDC links in India. Generally we assume that there is a, whenever we talk about HVDC, people says that there is a Rihand Dadri link and sometimes Chandrapur Padge also people say, but there are 12 numbers of links are there in service and some of the are under construction. So the first link, that is the Rihand Dadri link. it's a plus minus 500 kV, 1500 megawatt. And if we see the case of Indian grid, there are five regional grids: northern, western, southern, eastern, and northeast. So we know that before one grid, or one grid, one nation, and one frequency, 50 hertz, we were having all five regional grids operated separately or asynchronously. So all initially in India, all links were connected with the back-to-back terminal stations. Means use of HVDC is nothing new, not new for us. We were already using HVDC back-to-back terminal station to connect the regional grids. And some of the point-to-point transmission systems are also there, like Chandrapur Padghe. Chandrapur is at one eastern part of Maharashtra and Padghe is at the western part of Maharashtra. Rihan Dadri is also like a point-to-point transmission. And if you take the case of this Barsul Lower Sileru, so this is a we can say back-to-back HVDC which connect western part to the western part and the eastern part actually. And here Chandrapur Ramagundam, this is the back-to-back HVDC which connect western and the southern part. So like that, another links are also there, Sasaram. These are the back-to-back links to connect these grids, regional grids, with the other grids, other regional grids. Then we are having a Talcher Kolar link. This was longest link before Northeast Agra. It was the longest link. It was a longest link, and now the longest link is now Northeast Agra. This is the now highest length link. So this is the Mundra Mohindergarh. This is one of the HVDC installed by Adani Power. That is the application of this Electricity Act 2003, that anyone can take part in a transmission also. So Adani Power has installed their own link. So that is the also this way, this link is private HVDC link. It's a Mundra to Mohindergarh. Mundra is in Gujarat and Mohindergarh in Haryana. So this is the Adani Power's link. Same thing is shown here. Links are there. Here just one interconnection is India-Bangladesh interconnector. Already it is in service. India and Bangladesh are connected with the back-to-back HVDC. And we have planned to connect Sri Lanka with the India. That is under, we can say it is planning stage. That in future we will connect to the Sri Lanka. In this way we are trying to connect with the neighboring countries. So these are some of the details of the link. Now present status of ongoing HVDC project. This is the Champa Kurukshetra, 6000 megawatt plus minus 800 kV. Three poles taken into service and one pole is under progress. Then Raigarh Pugalur, this is also plus minus 800 kV ultra high voltage DC, 6000 megawatt. There are two bipoles. Each bipole can carry 3000 megawatt. So one bipole completed, one bipole is under progress. Then different technology, first time in India, that is voltage source converter based technology, plus minus 320 kV. It is a bipolar link having 2000 megawatt capacity. It's a between Pugalur through Thrissur. So these are the one pole likely to completed in the December 2020. So these are the some of the links. And renovation of the that is a back-to-back link already started, because our all links are old, near about 25 years old system. So all HVDC links except Chandrapur Padghe belongs to Power Grid, that is Power Transmission Utility, Central Power Transmission Utility. So this is the brief overview of the ongoing projects, and these are the some of the specifications or technical aspects of each project. So you can go through it. I will share the presentation, because if you go through it, it will take too much time. So later on you can read this. There are the some all details of each and every project is given here. Just I will share some speciality of one project. Something new technology is used first time in the world. This is Chandrapur Padge, one of the project. So Balia Bhiwadi is there. This is the first Adani's HVDC link, private HVDC link. And this is Northeast Agra. This is from Northeast to Agra, that is northern region. And it is coming from this chicken neck area. This area is known as chicken neck area because it looks like a chicken neck because it is too much a narrow area, 22 by 18 kilometer only. And from this there was the issue of power evacuation because of the right of way issues. So that's why they have installed here ultra high voltage DC multi-terminal HVDC link Northeast Agra, so that bulk power available from here or from Bhutan or like neighboring countries, you can take from here also. So that's why this corridor is created. So these are the three terminal stations. One is at Biswanath Chariali in Assam, second one is Alipurduar, and third is Agra. So this is in the northeast region, this is in the eastern region, and this is in the northern region. So there are three terminals. That's why it is known as multi-terminal ultra high voltage link. So these are the some of the specifications. The length of DC line is 1728 kilometer, near about we can say 1800 kilometer approx. And that Talcher Kolar link is near about 1300 kilometer. Now this is the longest link in India, but we have already seen China has already crossed 3000, more than 3000, that is a length of DC. So these are the three terminal stations. Every HVDC link has having some overload capacity for emergency purpose. Now this is the Champa Kurukshetra plus minus 800 kV 3000 megawatt link. The speciality of this link is generally in any HVDC project we use a rectifier inverter station as well as the earthing station, earth electro station, which should be away from our terminal station, that is 20 to 20 kilometer away from terminal station. So we generally use that, but here in this project they have not used this these earthing stations. Instead of that, what they did, they have installed one extra conductor on the line. So here one is positive pole, other is negative pole, and this is a neutral, actually the return path for this current. So that's why they have they get the benefit, though it is a capital cost increased. But the maintenance cost and that cost of electro station, that is compensated. So this is the best technology. It is installed by Alstom. Now future HVDC links that we already talked, that is from Sri Lanka and India, there will be the interconnection. So it is near about 285 kilometer and power handling capacity 1000 megawatt. And Reliance has also proposed one HVDC link which is based on voltage source converter, that is known as HVDC light link, but because of certain issues that is not coming now. But they have planned this voltage source converter by HVDC link, and this is the connection between Bangladesh grid and Indian grid. So there are these are the back-to-back terminal station through which we connect to the Bangladesh. This is the Sri Lanka and India interconnection. In India, this is Madurai end. There will be one terminal station. Then there is a transmission line. Then there is a cable. It's a submarine cable. This will be the submarine cable, 50 kilometers. And later on, there will be the transmission line. So this is a 150. So in this way, we are going to connect with the Sri Lanka. Now what is MIDC HVDC? MIDC means multi-infeed DC. We know that if we take the case of northern region, here already there was a line Rihand Dadri from long time. Next, then Balia Bhiwadi line came in the same region, and later on this ultra high voltage DC northeast Agra link also came into the same region. It means that three DC lines feeding into the same area, northern region. So how they will behave, or how the converters will behave, that was the one of the issue. But it is that in the studies that is not the case, and such technology is known as multi infeed DC, means many HVDC links feeding into the same area. It is known as multi infeed DC, and the studies related to the this HVDC is done at the CPIRI Bangalore. Whatever project we have to install HVDC, then we have to study this in the CPIRI Bangalore. There is a RTDS, real time digital simulator lab is there. So they did such studies there. Now we'll talk about these power electronic devices which are used for the conversion. The basic device, we know that it is a diode, which is a, we can say, uncontrolled switch. Then we have next thyristor, that is a semi-controlled switch, and next is a control switch, that is force commutated devices, that is IGBTs, GTOs or MOSFETs like that. Now comparison of the their frequencies, power handling capacities like this. If you take the case of thyristors, there are switching losses of 1 to 2% switching losses, and they can be used for the bulk power transmission, and they operate in the range of 50 to 60 hertz. When we take the case of GTOs, gate turn off thyristors, it operates in the range of less than 500 hertz. And when we talk about IGBTs or IGCTs, they operate beyond 1000 hertz, but the switching losses are 2 to 4%. But because of the technological upgradation, these losses now came down to 1 to 2%. Because of certain we can say switching technologies, they have reduced these losses. And we know that whenever we go on increasing the frequency of the switching, so that device we can operate in the real time. And any power electronic device, when we operate in the real time, so it will be controlled, the power system parameters, in real time. It means that we can achieve the stability tremendously. Only the switching is the issue, but that is also overcome with the technological upgrades. Now this PVQ, power, active power, voltage and Q, so that is controlled by these devices. They convert AC to DC, DC to AC like this. So in this way we can say that these devices, nowadays IGBTs are very popular, but the issue with the today also with the IGBTs, their power handling capacity is less, that is power rating is less. Near about this technology reached to 1000 to 1100 megawatt, and otherwise we have seen thyristor based technology 12 gigawatt also, 12000 megawatt like this. So there is a still limitation with this technology. That's why they are coming with the modular multi-level converters. So they are going to connect these IGBT modules in a series and parallel combination, so that they can enhance the power rating of this. Now types of HVDC, based on these devices, we can divide these technologies in three types. One is current source converter based HVDC, which is known as conventional, classical or classic HVDC. Then CCC HVDC is similar, it is at one type of current source converter based, that is capacitor commutated converter. Then there is a ultra high voltage DC, it's a plus minus 800 kV or plus minus 1100 kV also. Then VSC, that is a voltage source converter based HVDC. So the trademark of Siemens is HVDC light. HVDC plus it's a ABB HVDC light. HVDC plus is Siemens, and Maxine is by Alstom. So these are some of the companies which are actually supplying this voltage source converter based technology. And hybrid HVDC is a theoretical concept that is, at one end you can connect current source converter, at suppose a rectifier and a 8 inverter, you can connect that is a voltage source converter. Still the research is going in this field, whether it is possible or not, because at one end there is a thyristor based technology and at another end there is a voltage source converter technology. So how they will do the interaction of those converters, that is the topic of research. Now we'll see some of the basics of this HVDC transmission technologies. The first one is a classic HVDC or line commutated converters. Here power control is possible, then converter demands reactive power. This is the disadvantage of the current source converter technology, because whenever I have to transmit power in the DC by using thyristor based technology, I needed 50 to 60% reactive power at the local terminal station. That's why I have to provide filters here, passive filters, and sometimes shunt capacitors also to compensate the reactive power. It means that this converter demands more reactive power, near about 50 to 60%. Suppose I want to transmit 1500 megawatt power, real active power, then I should have to provide near about 50%, means 800 MVAr reactive power I have to supply at the terminal station, rectifier as well as inverter side. So that is the disadvantage of current source converter technology. Reactive power balance is sometimes achieved by shunt capacitor. Additional capacitors also we want for reactive power compensation. Then minimum system short circuit capacity of twice rated power. Means if I want to install any HVDC based on current source converter or thyristors, there must be some short circuit ratio capacity that must be twice of rated power. Suppose I want to install 1500 megawatt power, it means that the grid or that AC system which I want to connect with the HVDC, that should be having capacity of 3000 megawatt, like this or like that in between. Suppose take the case of Chandrapur Padighe. So near about it's a 1500 megawatt link. So at Chandrapur there is a 2200 megawatt power generated at super thermal power station, and at Padighe the bus is handling near about 2000 megawatt power. Means these are the strongest buses. Means short circuit ratio of those buses should be higher than 3, then you can use these line commutated converters or thyristor based technology. Then if the short circuit ratio is less than 3, still I want to use current source converter thyristor technology, then another technology I can go for, it's a capacitor commutated converters, CCC. Here what is the difference between two technologies? Just between the converter transformers and thyristor walls there are the series connected capacitors. That is the only difference, series connected capacitors. That's why it is known as capacitor commutated converters, and it can be used for the weak system. Though that bus is not strongest, but still this technology can be used. Then minimum system short circuit capacity of the rated power. The minimum short circuit capacity is needed. What is meant by short circuit capacity? It is a MVA short circuit divided by the power of the DC link. That will give you short circuit capacity. If it is a, suppose Padighe system 400 kV, so the voltage will be it's a root 3 VL V line to line into I fault. Suppose it is a V lines to line is 400 kV, and I fault current, that is maximum current fed by the AC system, is a 18 kilo amps. So that will be divided by whatever it comes and divided by 1500 megawatt. So that ratio definitely will come more than 3. Sometimes it may be 5 to 6 also. So that's why we can say that Padighe bus 400 kV, which I have to connect with the AC system, with the DC system, that must be very strong. Its short circuit ratio must be high. Short circuit ratio indicates that how much generation is connected to that bus, like this. Next technology is a HVDC light. based on the voltage source converter, thyristor based technology. And nowadays this technology becoming very popular because of its application for the renewable grid integration of renewables by this technology. There are many applications of this technology and there are many advantages also. See here, active and reactive power control, it's a independently possible. Here if I want to increase the active power near about 50% reactive power, I have to increase. But here we can independently control active and reactive power. We can play in the 360 degree with the active power and reactive power. Then dynamic voltage regulation, it has a dynamic voltage regulation, so that voltage can be regulated. Then it is a modular and expandable. It come in a modular form, expandable form, and we can easily transport this, and its installation is very easy. It's a very portable system. Then black start capability it has. If we take the case of current source converter, suppose we'll take the case of Chandrapur Padghe. Suppose if there is a failure at Padghe bus, suppose 400 kV AC system become dead. So in that case, though there is a power at Chandrapur site, generation site, still I cannot charge my HVDC another end at Padghe because of limitations with this current source converter technology. Because current source converter technology, for the operation of the thyristor valves, you must want some voltage. That's why these devices are known as line commutated devices. Whenever you feed the line voltages, then and then voltage will appear across anode and cathode of the thyristor. And then after getting the pulse, triggering pulse, then it will start conducting. It means that though one end is charged, I cannot charge the other end. That is the disadvantage of the current source converter technology or thyristor based technology. But there is no limitation with the voltage source converter technology. Suppose there is a voltage source converter in between two terminal station, if one fails, other can be energized through the other terminal. That's why it is becoming more popular for black start capability also. And it has no short circuit restrictions. We have already seen that to install any this conventional HVDC, we needed short circuit ratio higher than 3. And for if it is lower than 3, so it may be we can go for triple C HVDC. But if it is 0 means there is no generation connected to that bus, that is a dead end, we can say it's a load side only. In that case also you can connect that end with the HVDC by using voltage source converter based technology. That's why it has no short circuit restrictions. So that is the another advantage of the HVDC light technology. And same thing is shown here. These are the thyristor valves, converter transformer, classic line commutated converter technology, and these are the filters. Here triple C HVDC, just we have connected capacitors in series. That is the only difference between these two technologies. Okay, and this is the voltage source converter based technology where IGBTs are used as a conversion equipment, and DC side capacitors are provided, and this is a line resistance, and these are the reactors. Simple reactors are used. And also one of the advantage of these voltage source converter based technology, that we don't require converter transformers here. Conventional power transformers can be used to connect any AC system to step up or step down the voltages. But here in case of current source converter based technology, thyristor based technology, you must want this converter transformer. These are very specially designed transformer, very costly. One transformer, suppose it is 298.60 MVA, so it has a cost of 5 to 10 crores. So that is tremendous cost, and this simple power transformer comes into lakhs. So that is the benefit with this technology, why it is becoming popular. Okay, And in future, people are thinking about that, why should not we go for DC grids by using this technology? But there is a limitation with the DC breakers. If we DC breaker 100% get developed, then we can go for this DC grid formations by using the voltage source converter based technology. Now, new and applicability. This DC transmission you can use for longer distances, but AC with the FACTS we have another option. But when we talk about the longest cable transmission, more than 40 to 50 kilometers, then HVDC is uniquely suitable for that. There is no another option, because beyond 40 to 50 kilometers, if we go for the AC transmission with the cables, the losses will increase because of the highest charging current. So in that case, HVDC is uniquely suited for DC cable transmission. Then DC is also it is asynchronous links, that is 50 and 60 hertz regions can be connected with the HVDC. Like take the case of Japan, some region of Japan is working on 50 hertz and other is working on 60 hertz. Now they have connected these two regions with this HVDC system, back-to-back system. Then power control and modulation in AC system is possible with the help of DC. Otherwise, in AC system, we cannot have direct control over the power. The constraints of the AC system, AC transmission. We know that whenever distance increases, when we plot graph between power handling capacity and the distance, if whenever distance increases, the power handling capacity of the AC line goes on reducing. We know that as the distance increases, XLS, that is impedance, will be higher and losses will be more. So that is the issue. But that is the voltage and stability constraints are there. Then we have to go for series compensation like that. So then we can enhance this power rating, but cost is also increased. But when we see the DC, it is independent of the distance. It is not intersecting with distance. That's why there are the link which are in the world having a transmission length of that line is more than 3000 kilometer also, because it is independent of the X, that is a distance of the line. In HVDC, there are many controllers are there. Because of these controllers, the stability of our power system increases. So when we talk about the any parallel network, take the case of Chandrapur Padge. So this is a embedded HVDC link, means there is a surrounding, there are some AC lines also there from Chandrapur to Parli, Parlikan to Lonikan, Lonikan to Padge. So like that, some lines are coming parallel to HVDC link. So such a HVDC is known as embedded HVDC link. So here AC network is running parallel with the DC link. So there is a feature, or we can say control controller of to damp out the oscillations. Whenever there is a major fault in the power system, whether at rectifier or inverter station, so that will disturb the voltage frequency. And but because of the controllers, HVDC is having the sensing devices like a DCCT, DVDs, or AC side equipments, that is measuring equipments. Sorry. So that will sense the changes of the in the power system parameters, and according to that, link will adjust the power on it. Link will adjust power on it. So that's why always it is actually adjusting. Damping controller is always on, so that is adjusting whatever variations coming in the frequency, that is always compensated by DC link. That's why on the DC link there is always some variation in the power. So this is one of the, we can say, damping controllers. Another controllers are also there, that frequency controller, that we'll discuss later on. There is a one feature in the HVDC that is known as runoff function. Runoff function means this is a parallel AC line. Suppose there is a fault on this line, and this line, this circuit get out of, means it get disconnected from the power system. then suppose if it is carrying a 300 megawatt power, so if get tripped, then there is a feature in HVDC that is known as runoff function. So this 300 megawatt power lost by this AC line will be compensated on the DC line. So net effect in the power system will be nullified. So system will behave very stably. So that's why we can say that this is the runoff function used in HVDC. Now frequency controller. Frequency controllers, there are two regions.
Hello,
suppose
sir.
Yes.
There is a voice break.
Voice break is there.
Sir, there is a voice break.
Okay, okay.
Yes, sir. Sir, can you please switch off your camera?
Switch off?
So that network is sufficient for audio one, audio channel.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, yeah. Sorry.
Video, video only.
Video?
So that we can hear audio.
Yeah, yeah.
Sir, video off karenge to net acha rahega audio.
Yes, yes. Definitely, it will improve certain extent, I think so. Now it is it okay? Hello?
Yes sir, now it's clear.
Okay.
Yes sir, it's clear.
If something goes wrong, please tell like this. Okay, now we'll see the frequency controllers. Frequency controller come into picture whenever there is a major grid disturbance. Now we, you know that already before some days this Mumbai gets islanded. So such cases we can say that major grid disturbance, there is a, we can say, frequency controller come into action. And in frequency controller, whenever there is a sudden change in the frequency, so that according to that frequency controller will come into action and it will enhance the power on the link. Suppose there is a failure in this region, this is a suppose load side and this is generation side. Suppose there is a grid failure here, so it will try to, and some lines are still connected. So this HVDC link will try to enhance the power. Suppose normal rating, power rating is 1500 megawatt, P is 1500 megawatt. So it will enhance delta P like 500 megawatt. So 1500 plus 500, so it will be 2000 megawatt. But just for 5 seconds, not more than that. Otherwise, our these all equipments will be stressed by the continuous 2000 megawatt loading, and it doesn't have that much power handling capacity of the equipments. But just for 5 seconds, it can overload up to 2000 megawatt also. And in this way, the deficiency of power in this region for 5 seconds can be mitigated more than 1500, that is 2000 megawatt. In this way, frequency controller come into action and try to survive this region in case of major grid disturbance. So this feature is known as frequency controller. Now economics of long distance transmission. For same amount of power, if I am to transmit from the DC and AC, DC requires less ROW, that is the right of way. Cheaper towers, less conductor, insulator cost is less, but the terminal equipment cost is high. We can say that capital investment is more in case of DC, but operational cost is less in case of AC. Power can be controlled, ground return is possible. Suppose there is a fault on AC line, permanent nature fault, it will trip. But whenever there is a fault on the poles, DC line, so one pole will trip, another will be continue through either metallic return, that is the conductor of the other pole. If the line of the trip pole is healthy, then it can use as a return path. And otherwise, earth is used as a return path. This is the biggest advantage of HVDC. You can use earth as a conductor for return path of the DC current. That is very interesting, that we will see in detail. then transformation of voltage level is not possible with the help of transformers in case of DC. We have to go for installation of any new terminal station if I want to tap any DC line. So I have to actually install one DC terminal station. So that is the issue. Then that most of the things we already covered, that is reduce voltage, one of the area which we have to discuss. Reduce voltage when there is a temporary nature fault in case of AC line. That AC line, if it is 400 kV line, then it is it attempts on auto reclose and it try to recover. If it is again permanent nature fault, it will trip. Similarly, if there is a temporary nature of fault on the DC line, so what it will do, it will actually goes on reduce voltage. So our voltage rating of Chandrapur Padgi, it is a plus minus 500 kV. But whenever there is a temporary nature fault, then that voltage will go on reduced. That is 500 will come to 400 kV DC. If it is on both poles, then it will be plus minus 400 kV DC. And the power handling capacity will reduce to 1000 megawatt. If it is bipolar, if it is a monopolar, it comes to 500 megawatt from 750 megawatt. With this reduced rating, reduced power, this actually starts power flowing. Means temporary nature of fault, there is a reduced voltage operation. This is the feature in HVDC. If it is permanent nature fault, then it will trip. But there is a redundancy that if one pole trips, the other will take over like this with the half reduced capacity. Then reactive power support for long AC lines. Actually, whenever there is a HVDC link in the AC system, so it will actually, its filters at rectifier and inverter will help to maintain the voltage profile or reactive power compensation to the grid which is connected to rectifier as well as inverter. So this is also one of the benefit. That's why for load dispatch center, it is very supportive whenever there is a HVDC link in that network. Whenever there is an issue of low voltage, then we can take one filter into service, that is 200 MVAR. So it will enhance the voltage of the grid local area 4 to 5 kV. So by taking additional filter, you can enhance the voltage rating can be improved, voltage profile can be improved. So this is the benefit with the filters. Also, there is in HVDC, there is one mode which is known as reactive power absorption mode. Suppose in AC system, there is a over voltage into the system. In that case, if I operate my HVDC system in reduced voltage, reactive power absorption mode, in that case, excessive reactive power available on that bus will be absorbed into the reactors of the filters, passive filters on the AC side. In this way, we can maintain the voltage profile. So that is that's why we can say that voltage profile and stability can be improved by the HVDC system. Then it has a, we can say, power flow can be controlled very high speed. It has a power hand, that is a ramping speed of 200 megawatt per minute. That much we can ramp the power on the link. Then additional grid flexibility in the grid operation. We already discussed, that is how the filters can manage the voltage profile of the grid. That is the benefit. Then firewall against grid disturbances. It's an electrical firewall, actually HVDC, because if suppose there is a fault on the DC side, on rectifier or inverter side, still that fault will not reflect on the other side because of the controllers embedded into the HVDC control system. So that will take care of all the grid disturbances on the either on rectifier side or inverter side. So that's why it is acting as an electrical firewall to the power system. देन देर इज अ नो स्किन इफेक्ट प्रॉक्सिमिटी इफेक्ट ऑफ द एचवीडीसी सिस्टम. देन डिस्टेंस देर इज नो, वी ऑलरेडी सी डिस्टेंस इज इंडिपेंडेंट. कोरोना इफेक्ट लेस सिग्निफिकेंट एज कंपेयर टू द, बिकॉज कोरोना इज मोर प्रोमिनेंट वेन देर इज अ फ्रिक्वेंसी, बट पॉजिटिव पोल एंड निगेटिव पोल हैज समथिंग डिफरेंट बिहेवियर रिगार्डिंग कोरोना. देन एनवायरमेंटल बेनिफिट्स, राइट ऑफ वे इज लेस रिक्वायर्ड. देन नो कॉन्ट्रीब्यूशन टू द शॉर्ट सर्किट लेवल ऑफ ए सी बस कनेक्टेड. वट इज माई शॉर्ट सर्किट लेवल? दैट इज वी हैव ऑलरेडी सीन MVA शॉर्ट सर्किट वेन एवर देर इज अ फॉल्ट ऑन द ए सी बस. So that will, the highest fault current fed by that bus, so that will be the MVA short circuit. So that is a short circuit level. So whenever HVDC is connected to the grid, whenever we talk about thyristor based technology, so there is no contribution to the short circuit level. Means whenever HVDC is connected, it will get disconnected. Whenever there is a fault in the AC system, it will isolate from the rest of system and it will not contribute to the fault level. So it is true with the current source converter based technology, but not for the voltage source converter technology. In voltage source converter technology, there is no breaker directly, we can say DC breaker, and IGBTs having the anti-parallel diodes are connected. So because of those anti-parallel diodes, the fault current for some time feeded till the opening of the AC side breakers. So that is the one of the disadvantage of the voltage source converter technology for the isolation. That's why people are going for invention of the DC breakers. And if it is developed by ABB DC breaker, it's a hybrid DC breaker, but still that is not we can say practically we can apply into the system. Some research is still going on into that. Then we can exactly power flow, we can control within the limit. Then we can use the generating capacity efficiently. Whatever power you produce, you should produce at Himalaya, and you can supply to the Kanyakumari also with the help of HVDC, because there is very less loss and there is no distance limitation. So where you should produce power in any pocket of any region, and that you can feed to the grid with the less losses, with the more stability. So that is the efficient use of generating capacity. These are the losses. Losses are less in case of DC. In ideal case, if we take, there is no inductance, capacitance, resistance, but in practically there are RLC parameters when we feed power through the AC system. But when we use the DC system, then L and C is absent, line has only resistance. So that's why the losses are very less in case of DC. Tower material needed is less if we compare with the 765 kV AC and plus minus 600 kV DC. Just we can calculate 36 tons and here 16 tons. So less than half of the amount of steel can be used when we compare with the AC and DC systems. Right of way needed is very less. If we see here, when we go for the EHV 400 kV lines, so right of way that much we required. But when we go for the EHV lines 400 kV with the fax devices, fax technology, then one again this corridor gets reduced. But when we go with the DC, with the overhead DC, again this ROW we reduced. But when we go with the underground DC, then there is no issue of ROW. So that is the, that we can show here also, ROW needed for the corridors AC and DC. This can be shown with one animation also. This much we save if we go for the overhead DC. And when we go for the underground, there is no issue of ROW. Now we'll see the functioning of the thyristors. It's most important सॉरी, दिस इज अ ट्रांजिशन डायग्राम. एक्चुअली व्हाट हैपन्स इन थायरिस्टर्स दैट वी ट्राई टू अंडरस्टैंड हाउ इट गोज फ्रॉम ऑफ टू ऑन स्टेट एंड ऑन टू अगेन ऑफ स्टेट. What are the stages of its operation that we will see here. We know that thyristor is a most important device for the power conversion from AC to DC or to DC to AC. It's a four layer, three junction device, anode, cathode and gates are there. And this is the transition diagram actually how it works here. This is, we plotted a VI characteristics of the thyristors. See here, whenever grid, this link is in off condition, de-energized condition, all the thyristors are in off condition. When I want to start the link, I have to apply AC voltage from the either AC side, means both sides of the rectifier as well as inverter side. From the both AC side, I have to apply voltages. So later on voltage develop across anode and cathode of each thyristors, and then gate pulse is applied. Then this off condition thyristor goes into the on state. So later on, then again there is a condition, because there is a RYB thyristor wall, so sequentially it should operate so as to produce the output sequentially. RYB, as per the phase difference, each wall should conduct like that. One in first half cycle, that is a upper leg and lower leg like that. So here this is a VI characteristics. Then when the R phase wall is conducting, so Y and B are thyristors in that link are actually temporary off condition. So when temporary off condition comes, when IAK is less than I holding current. So here we can say that this is the minimum current, holding current, I holding current, and if it is a less, the current flowing through anode and cathode is less than I holding, then it comes to the temporary off condition. But from temporary off to on condition, whenever there is a RYB cycle, in the next cycle again R phase comes. In that case, when Y and B conducts, R phase thyristor has to stay in temporary off condition. But again R phase comes, again it comes to the on condition, and this on condition is decided by the its duration of off. It must be T off, less than T off. Suppose T off is 9 millisecond, and from off to on, and on to temporary off, to temporary off to off. So it is completely with 9 millisecond, this is 3 millisecond, this is 3, and this is 3 millisecond. Suppose we take like this. When it compares, temporary off duration is less than T off. T off we know that it is 9 millisecond. It compared, temporary off duration is less than T off. If it is okay, then it goes to temporary off to on condition. If it is more than 9 millisecond, then it will go to complete off condition. So these are the some of the logics, how the program of firing of the thyristors is developed based on these logics. So this, if you understand this logic, then we'll know how the programming is there. So temporary off to off condition, just it will compare of temporary off duration. If it is more than T off, if it is more than 9 milliseconds, suppose it is 12 milliseconds, then it means that thyristor has to completely stop, means link has to stop. So this is just a transition diagram. It is very useful. Then operation of the current source converters. Whenever you vary the firing angle, so by varying the firing angle, we can varying this output will be varied. If it is a firing angle we are adjusting, and according to that, one wall from the upper leg and one wall from the lower leg in the return path will conduct. So in this way, like this, suppose like this. So these are the some of the operation. This can be shown with the one presentation here. these are the question.
This is R. Then this is actually yellow is not, green is used, and one is blue. So whenever there is a this is at higher potential, and this is at higher potential in the negative side. So that's why these walls are conducting. In the forward path it is like this, and in the return path this lower leg is conducting like this. And for the next cycle, now it is higher side on the upper positive and lower negative side. This now blue is, we can say, at higher potential than green. That's why this wall come into picture. So in this way, these are the operations happen in case of rectifier operation. So in this way conduction takes place. Now by adjusting the firing angle from 0 to 30, this is 180 degree. So 0 to 180 degree, so 0 to, this is one operation, that is 0 to 90 degree. The walls are acting as a rectifier, in a rectifier mode, and when firing angle is 90 to 180, then these walls are acting is a in the inverter operation. So generally 18 degree is a maximum output we will get, firing 5 is a minimum angle, but 18 degree is a maximum, that you get a maximum output in the 18 degrees like this. So this is the rectifier and inverter operation. How the DC will be controlled by this, by controlling the firing angle. But if you see, generally at the rectifier firing angle, alpha is controlled and gamma is controlled at the inverter side. It's an extension angle, gamma. Gamma is equal to 180 minus alpha minus mu, like that, where mu is a overlap angle. Principle of working, whenever at one end, suppose this is R, R and V phases are in conduction. So similarly, here same phases will come into conduction. At an inverter side also, same phases will come into this conversion process. So this is the principle of operation. These are some of the basic formulae that are very important to understand the logic, how this power transmission happens on the DC link. VDC, we know that it's a 3 root 2 by pi into cos alpha into V lines to line RMS. Then rectifier end voltage can be modified from this equation, where XCR is a commutating reactance and IDC is the power, that is a command given by the operator, IDC. So in this way, and these are some of the factors. Gamma, alpha, gamma is there. Gamma is at the inverter, alpha is at the rectifier. So this is PDC is equal to VDCR minus VDCI divided by R into VDCR. In this way, power can be calculated. So you can logic, you can understand with this equation, you can understand the logic behind the how DC actually works. Now modes of operation. In the modes of operation, there are the most economical load is bipolar mode. So this is the both poles, positive poles and negative pole, are both are in service, each carrying 750 megawatt. And this is the neutral side of the this. Whenever bipolar link is there, the whatever the potential difference between plus minus voltages, because of that small some current will flow through this ground. In the balance condition, most of it is less than 10 amps when their system is balanced. But suppose one pole fails, make all trip, or some station equipment is having problem, then this pole will not available. Then we can operate this system in the monopolar mode. It's a monopolar ground return mode. This is the one of the option I have. 750 megawatt means 1500 megawatt power will flow through the ground. That is the benefit of HVDC. We can use earth as a return path. Actually 1500 megawatt power current flows through the ground. So that is the magic with the HVDC. In this way circuit gets completed. Here suppose this pole is not available, there is a problem, line fault is there, that's why I have preferred this mode. If suppose line is healthy, I can go for the another mode also. I can use this line as a return path so that I can avoid this earth path, because through the earth there is a corrosion and erosion of the electrostation equipments. So that's why we can actually use this electrode, line of the other pole as a return path. So these are the, this is the monopolar metallic return mode, like this. Applications, we can use this HVDC for the undersea cables, submarine cables, certain longer distances, interconnection of different grids, networks, like back-to-back terminal stations, then combination of the above. At certain distance you can use line, after that you can use cables like that. Then conventional and non-conventional energy sources we can connect. Now there is a most of European countries, they are preferring this voltage source converter based technology. They are installing these offshore wind farms in the sea, because in the sea when you go for the offshore windmills, the output is 70% more than the onshore windmills. Continuous wind flow is there, so you will get 70% more power here. So that's why Denmark, Germany, US, they have installed such windmills in the sea. Then major hydros, that power they can harness with the HVDC. Then again people are going for the these like solar power connection with the grid, like this. And these are some of the limitations of HVDC. These are some of the limitations. Just a minute, I will drink the water. Now the limitations of HVDC. We know that there is a high cost of conversion equipments, but because of the technological development, now the cost of IGBTs, then this thyristors becoming or getting reduced. As the company like Hitachi, they also come into the HVDC, and we know that now there is a too much competition in the field of HVDC, that's why costing get reduced. Converter station size large, that can be reduced by using CCC or VSC HVDC. Then ancillary component like filters, power electronic devices, thermal management systems, that also can be compensated. If we shift the harmonics on the higher side, then we don't require more filters. In case of voltage source converter based technology, if they use PWM technique, pulse width modulation, because of that they shift the harmonics on the higher side, so the filter requirement gets reduced. In case of CCC also, filter requirement gets reduced. And if you go for higher pulse group, like 24 pulse converters in place of 12 pulse converter, your first harmonic will be 23rd and 25th, so there are again requirement of filter get reduced. That's why in plus minus 800 kV they used 24 pulse converter. Then high cost of DC circuit breakers. Yeah, we know that DC circuit breaker, particularly MRTB metallic return transfer breaker, is a DC breaker. That is, we can say partial DC breaker, not perfect DC breaker. So that is only used to change the mode of from monopolar metallic return to ground return. That is the only purpose of that breaker. So cost is more, but because of competition and technological development, these costs are getting reduced. We cannot use transformers, we have to tap the DC line, then we have to install one terminal station. Harmonics generated in the power system, but that can be compensated by the filters, we can shift those harmonics on the higher side by higher pulse group. Complexity of control, now if you use the artificial intelligence, now so that complexity of the controls can be reduced. Link charging problem during grid failure, instead of that you can go for the voltage source converter technology for the link charging issue. Short circuit ratio must be higher than 3. This was limitation with the current source converter technology, but now CCC and VSC is the one of the solution. Even voltage source converter technology you can use for the short circuit ratio 0 also. Then converter consumes reactive power, that is with the true with the voltage source converter, current source converter technology, but not for the voltage source converter technology. So these are some of the limitations already managed by the technological upgradation. Now some of the equipments we will see, some equipments, most of some special equipments in HVDC, that is a DC voltage divider, otherwise CVT, CTs, that is the conventional equipments. We will only focus on the specialized equipments which are used for the DC measurements and protection. So this is the DC voltage divider. It's a 500 kV DC. It is 500 kV by 5 volt. It's a ratio. And in the neutral side, it is 50 kV by 2 volt ratio. So how it works, these are the actually, this DVD is a resistive type, and there is a, we can divide this 500 kV voltage across the resistors, and across the resistor some capacitor internal, that arrangement is there, and we goes on reducing this 500 kV voltage across the resistors, and ultimately then we measure these voltages. This goes to HL cables, this goes to the measurement panel, DYM, DC yard measurement, and then it is actually converted into the voltage signal. There are the converters, generally voltage signal is given to the control system, control and protection system. So this is the, we can say, DC voltage divider. It's a works on the DC voltage divider arrangement. Now this is a DC CT which is having a ratio of 1500 ampere by 2 volt. Generally if you see the AC side CT is having a 1500 ampere by 1 ampere, like that ratio, but here the secondary is showing 2 volt because it is a transducer. This DC CT is known as zero plug CT, and it is known as DC current transducer or zero plug CT or universal CT. So where this is the arrangement, how it works. This is the primary of the this current transducer. This whenever there is a power, suppose 750 megawatt is flowing through that pole, so that current is a corresponding current is 1500 ampere. So 1500 ampere in the secondary, so this secondary is there. Whenever current flows, whether it is AC or DC, it will, if it is DC, it will produce some magnetic field, magnetic flux, but it is a constant magnetic field as it is a DC. And here some field is developed in the primary, and there is some magnetic field detection circuit arrangement is there in this CT, and there is a power amplifier. So what it do, it sends this power amplifier sends the current in the reverse direction, opposite direction, and whatever flux created by the primary will cancel out by the secondary, and whenever that flux get cancelled, then that compensating current is known as, it is measured when it is 1500 amps, it is 0.875 amps in this secondary side. So this is the compensating current. It means that whenever the flux get cancelled, it means that if it is primary is 1500 ampere, it means that secondary is 0.875 amps. So then we can say that if it is 0.875, it means that in the primary there is a 1500 ampere current. So in this way, there is an indirect measurement of the DC current. So this is the magnetic field detection circuit, and this current finally comes to one resistor, and it measures into that is ultimately you will get 2 volt for the 1500 ampere. So in this way we measure the DC current. Now these are the neutral breakers. Actually in HVDC, if there is a fault on the DC line, there is no breaker on the, we have seen the single line diagram, we have seen that in the AC side there are the breakers, but in DC side there are no circuit breakers. Why it is so? These breakers are only in the neutral part. These are conventional breakers, SF6 type breakers. These are conventional breakers, and MRTB is only one breaker which is only present at the rectifier end, that is at Chandrapur end, metallic, which is a semi DC breaker we can say, which actually switch over the current, that is a metallic return to ground return mode. Here these breakers are conventional breakers, so there is no need of breaker on the DC line. On 500 kV level you will never find out any breaker. Why? Because whenever there is a fault on the DC line, that thyristor itself will take care of that. Means thyristor wall itself act as a breaker. Suppose there is a fault, so the fault current and fault voltage, that will change. So that will give command to the control system. Control system will give command to the thyristor walls, and firing pulses will be stopped, and those firing pulses will be stopped, and that the operation of the thyristor will stop. In this way the fault current will not feed from the system, and indirectly it gets isolated from the faulty system. So that's why we don't require breaker on the 500 kV side. Why in the neutral breakers are given? Just it is for maintenance and for isolation, de-energization of the circuit for maintenance purpose, and to change the mode of system from monopolar metallic return to ground return, ground return to metallic return, like this. That is the only purpose. Otherwise there is no need of DC breaker on 500 kV level. And DCCT, that we already discussed, DCCT, this is a neutral part actually, DCCT. A smoothing reactor. This is smoothing reactor, we smoothen the DC output. We know that whenever there is a conversion, there is a production of harmonics, as well as some of the content, whenever there is a conversion into DC, there are the some spikes present into the DC. Those are AC spikes. So that spikes we have to remove. For that, this is a series inductor. This is a series connection, series inductor connected. It is having capacity of 360 millihenry, 1700 amps, 566 kV. This is the rating. And it may be oil filled, oil cooled, or air cooled. Air cooled, air cored we can say. So in case of Chandrapur Padge, we are using oil filled reactors. And in case of Talcher Kolar Link, they have used air cooled reactors instead of oil filled, because those are maintenance free. This is the thyristor walls inside structure. These are the layers. In one layer there are the 4 modules of the thyristors. In one module there are the 6 thyristors, means 24 thyristors in one layer. So like this, 1 2 3 4, so this forms one single wall V1. This is sub wall V1. There are 4 sub walls in one main wall. There are 4 sub walls in one single sub wall. There is a 4 layers, 1 2 3 4, and in one layer there are 24 thyristors. So in one sub wall there are 96 thyristors. 96 into 4, it's a 396. So that will be 384. So that will be total thyristors in one phase. So 384 into 3. So that will be 1152 thyristors for one pole. And 1152 into 2, that will be for the bipolar system. So in this way, these are the thyristors, series connected devices. So 384 thyristors are connected in series, then 384 in the another in parallel, 384 another in the parallel, like this. This is the inspection cage, in especially first time in India, Chandrapur Padge project has having gallery. You can go near to the, in live condition, energized condition. This is known as Faraday's cage. where all the induction effect will be nullified. This is wall cooling system. This is the wall cooling system, okay, to cooling the thyristor walls. This is converter transformer. AC filters, and this is electrode, line and station. So these are the electro station sites more than 20 km away from the terminal station because of to avoid the corrosion effect. And these are the electrodes buried inside the ground 3 to 3.5 meters deep. Whenever there is a monopolar ground return mode, then all the current flows through the ground and earth is used as a return path. So earth is used as a conductor for DC transmission. And now this is the micro grids, smart grids and super grids. There is a concept. This HVDC is playing a very big important role in to connect the renewable energy sources with the grid for stability. Also, it is acting as a expressways, express highways, like a in super grids. We can transmit 3,000, 6,000. Even China is transmitting 12,000 megawatt power on this DC links. So that is the benefit of the HVDC. And in near future, all countries are trying to connect with their neighboring countries, and with the help of HVDC, the day will come where all whole world will come together. So there will be the connection of the whole world, and that will be the formation of international grid. So then there will be the code of, now we are strict to the grid coding, then there will be the international grid coding. It may also happen in future because many countries are already connected, like Argentina, Brazil, nearest Sweden, then US, they are getting connected, nearest countries. So after some time, whole world may connect to one grid. Now small portion of this today's our discussion, that is static work, compensator work. That is in the simple way, it's a reactive power management. It may be manually, sometimes you can use at your substations, you can use reactors, manual operations. And sometimes you can go for the thyristor control devices, or you can with the reactor in combination with the capacitors, thyristor switch capacitors you can use, filters you can use. So these are the reactive power management techniques, static work compensators. And now there are two famous technologies, that is one is using thyristor as a power electronic device, and another is STATCOM by using the IGBTs. So in India, we are having more than 10, we are the STATCOMs in the grid. So they are compensating, or they are providing this stable operation in the system. So this is the static work compensation for reactive power management, we can say. Some these are the passive and active compensation, like active in case say we can say HVDC links, that is current source converter base, then the voltage source converter base, STATCOMs, these are the active, because here we use active components like thyristors, IGBTs, like that. And here we can say we can use passive sources like RLCs that can be used, sometimes asynchronous motors also, to manage the reactive power. So in this way, this is the SVC operation. So now this is a time to having a question answer session. These are some of the I have some activities. I have one industry institute technical forum. So near about 180 sorry near about one more than 100 students are connected here. So if you are interested, you can join this. Contact number, email IDs, all these given. So we'll having a technical discussion regarding conferences and all those things. Field is a like a institute and industry technical forum, so you can join it. And we are conducting some webinars also. So this will be our future webinars, so you can attend these webinars. If you join, you can attend these webinars, so it will be better. So now you can unmute yourself and you can ask the queries, because at one I have another session from another college. So please I am requesting to all of you, if you have some queries, you can ask. About what?
Wall arresters.
Wall arresters. Actually, wall arresters, see, in HVDC at each level of equipments, we are having individual lightning arresters for the protection from the lightning. Whenever there is an entry of line, there is a lightning arrester. In case of filters, DC side, we are having lightning arresters. Every equipment level we are having lightning arresters. Similarly, we are for the protection of the thyristor walls from the lightning surges, so that we provide the lightning arresters in shunt with the connection with the walls, so that if suppose primary lightning arrester failed because of some reasons, so this will directly not come, that lightning stroke will not come and damage the thyristor walls. So there is a, that's why these wall arresters are used.
Okay, sir.
Okay.
So one more question. What is the logic between star in 1/6 pulse and star delta in another 6 pulse?
Yeah. Logic is that we have to actually reduce the cost of installation. If we adjust the harmonics on the higher side, then it will very easy for the elimination, as well as cost of filtering will reduced. If you will take the case of 12 pulse converter, it means that 6 pulse connected in series. So the first harmonic by 1/6 pulse converter is 5th and 7th, and another is 5th and 7th harmonic. But if I am not using star delta combination, because in star delta in secondaries there is a 30 degree phase shift, means 5th and 7th harmonic produced by one converter, 1/6 pulse converter, will be cancelled out by the another 6 pulse converter. That's why in my system, whenever this harmonic comes, there will be no component of 5th and 7th harmonic, because of adopting star delta 30 degree phase shift, we have neutralized or we have cancelled out the 5th and 7th component of each 6 pulse converter. That is the logic behind it.
Okay, sir, but in the output we are getting 11th and 13th harmonic.
Yeah, we will get, because we have only provision that in star delta 30 degree phase shift, 6 pulse, that is 5th and 7th, can be cancelled out. But another harmonics, it will not cancel out. There is no compensating arrangement. Only those harmonics will be basic fund. For n is equal to 1, the basic those harmonics will be cancelled out. Later on, we have to provide the filters.
Thanks. Thank you.
Okay. Welcome. Any other queries? It is my request to all of you, please join here, so that will be beneficial to having interaction with the industry as well as the institute, so that we jointly can grow and develop ourselves. Okay, any other queries? Later on also, if you have queries, this I have given email ID and contact number. So later on also, you can contact.
Sure, sir.
If there is no queries, should we leave this session or any queries, another participants? Should we leave the session?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so once again I am thankful to all of you for your patience and hearing whatever I have shared. वेरी नाइसली वेरी इंटरेस्टिंगली यू लिसन सो थैंक्स टू ऑल ऑफ यू एंड थैंक्स टू यूर इंस्टीट्यूट दैट इज NPTI फॉर गिविंग मी दिस गोल्डन अपॉर्चुनिटी टू एक्सप्रेस माई वट एवर नॉलेज गेन फ्रॉम द फील्ड एज वेल एज थेरी सो आई एम रियली थैंकफुल टू ऑल ऑफ यू थैंक यू
थैंक यू सर
थैंक यू बी इन टच ओके थैंक्स या थैंक यू